Morning, everybody. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
He is risen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Great to see everybody here this morning, and I welcome you. If you're a guest with us, my name is Brian. I'm one of our pastors here, and we are so grateful that you have chosen to be with us here today. There is a Connect QR code that is on the screen. You can scan that at any time or fill out one of the cards that are in or around you in a pew, and let us have that after the gathering. We would love to be able to connect with you and just get to know you a little bit more, so grateful that we can all be here today to gather to worship our risen Savior. Just as a reminder for giving, if you would like to continue to worship through giving, you can do so via the QR code that's on the screen or via giving the old-fashioned way, if you will, to one of our ushers as you depart here this morning. But before I pray, I want to do our New City Catechism question for the week. Every single week, we go through a question throughout the 52 weeks of the year. And thus far, we've been looking at the law of God, the Ten Commandments. And we're now at the point for question 13 that says, can anyone keep the law of God perfectly? Can anyone keep the law of God perfectly? And you see the answer there on the screen. I want to invite you to read the answer back with me during this time. Let's read together. Since the fall, no mere human has been able to keep the law of God perfectly, but consistently breaks it in thought, word, and deed. You know, that sounds like bad news, doesn't it? It's bad news because, in a sense, it is. We cannot keep the law of God perfectly. However, the whole point of why we gather here this morning is to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. As Jesus went to the cross on Good Friday and died for us in our place, bearing the weight of sin and shame, our sin and shame on the cross, he went as the substitute. He went and died the death that we should have died after living a life that we should live. And because he has resurrected and he is alive today, we can worship and we can celebrate knowing that there is true opportunity to come to the Father and be saved. And you're going to hear more about that today as Pastor Walter preaches on the resurrection. So if you would, I'm going to pray, and then we're going to stand and worship. Would you pray with me? Father in heaven, Lord, we are so grateful, Lord, for you. Lord, we gather here on this Easter Sunday, this day where we celebrate and remember the resurrection. Lord, you are no longer laying there in the tomb. You have gotten up. You have resurrected. The stone has been rolled away. Death has been defeated. Oh God, we are so grateful. We are so grateful that Jesus has conquered the grave. And Lord, as we gather here this morning, Lord, we gather to celebrate that truth. We gather to celebrate the resurrection. We gather to worship the risen Lord. Lord, we gather to sing songs of praise unto you. We gather to sit underneath the teaching of your word. We gather to witness with our eyes new life in Christ through baptism this morning. Oh, Lord, you are so good. We pray, Lord, that during this time, Father, that distractions be minimized, that our focus would be on you, Lord, that we would give you all the worthy praise that you are worthy of. God, we love you. Lord, we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand and sing with us?
Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that we could see it all made new?
We do.
Is all creation groaning?
It is.
Is a new creation coming?
It is.
be the light within our midst.
It is.
Is it good that we remind ourselves of this?
The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? He is.
Does the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
Forever those he loves.
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us?
He does.
Anyone worthy?
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone the Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave? He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priest to God, to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy?
Next song, I want to read to you quickly what I read to the worship team this morning before we began thinking about how worthy the Lord is. Revelation 5:8, and when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lord, each holding a harp and golden bowls of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, "Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransom people for God from every tribe, every language, people, and nation." This is our great God.
Thank you.
Holy and righteous is his name. Sing, my soul, sing out and bless the Lord, for he has overcome. Oh, by his precious blood, now he's lifted. Come, let us lift up.
filled with glory. Let our hearts be filled with praise. You are worthy, God Almighty, holy, holy, holy.
Let the earth be filled with glory. Let our hearts be filled with praise. You are worthy, God Almighty, holy, holy, holy.
Praise God.
I can't wait for eternity. Join the song they're already singing. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Just to bow down before your throne. See your face, I'll cry out, because you're holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Sing Jesus.
Jesus, King of Kings. Jesus,
standing with those who have heard, well done, proclaiming forever that you're the one who's faithful, faithful, faithful are you, Lord. What can we give you but endless praise? The heavens roar as we shout your name. Jesus, Jesus, you are Lord.
Jesus King.
Jesus King of Kings. Jesus, Majesty. Jesus, King of Kings,
the Lord of Lords,
Jesus, Majesty.
Sing worthy.
Worthy, 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 Lord. Another glimpse of glory, we'll sing once more. Worthy, 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 Lord, forever, forever singing. Worthy, 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 Lord, another glimpse of glory, sing once more. Worthy. Jesus, Majesty.
worthy, Lord, another glimpse of glory. We'll sing once more, worthy, 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 Lord, forever.
Amen, amen. You guys may be seated. Apologize that I presume that you were waiting on me for permission to sit. You guys know what you're doing. My name is Walter. I'm one of the pastors here. I'm grateful that you would join us on this beautiful Easter Sunday. I know there's so many things you could be doing, so many things that you could be a part of today, and you choose to be with us. I don't want to take that lightly, and I'm grateful that you're worshiping with us today. We're continuing our series on worthy, speaking of the one who is worthy of all praise and honor. You may have heard his name today, and his name is Jesus. And today, there are a lot of things we could talk about. But the primary, most important thing we're going to talk about is the resurrection. We're going to talk about the resurrection because what else can you talk about on Easter Sunday? What else can you focus on after Holy Week but the resurrection? And so as we look at this passage in Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 15, we're looking at this idea of an unlikely faith. You see, as we look at this passage, the resurrection is just an unlikely thing that God would do, God would use to shape and make his world known, to make his glory known. As we consider this idea of unlikely things, an unlikely thing occurred in our house over the last couple of months. We acquired a cat. We've become a cat family. I know it's a wild and crazy thing, but as we have been talking about getting another pet, my son has been adamant we needed another pet, a pet that would do something besides sleep, like our 12-year-old dog, a pet that would do anything beyond sleep. And he made this long pros and cons list and saying, here's what mom and dad are going to be okay with, and here's what they're not going to be okay with. And you can imagine that no list is very long for a 10-year-old boy. He wanted a snake. He wanted a tarantula. He wanted a rat. He wanted a mouse. He wanted a ferret. I mean, just anything that is smelly and rodent-like, it was on his list. We shot everything down. And he finally came to the conclusion the only thing that would be acceptable to mom and dad was a cat. And so we settled on the fact that one day we would get a cat, emphasis on the one day. And my son, unbeknownst to us, began to pray for this cat to arrive in our house. He began to pray that God would bring him a cat. Never said anything to us, didn't have a conversation with us. He just simply began to pray that God, if you're there, give me a cat. Well, we went for a walk, beginning of December, and out comes this mangy, underweight cat that starts circling us on the walk. And I very stupidly made the joke, well, if the cat follows us home, we'll keep it, right? Because what cat in their right mind is going to follow us for 3/4 of a mile and make it home? Well, I'll be darned if at the end of that walk, that cat did not walk into our house and make herself at home. And so now we have a cat. Her name is Pepper. Perry can tell you all of these things about her. Yet, this cat has been one of the bigger parts of even just Perry's faith journey. Perry sitting here praying that God, if you care, if you know me, if you love me, this is a way you can show that love to me. This is a way you can display that you're here, you're listening, and you care. And isn't it wild that God would use this unlikely thing of an underweight, undernourished cat prancing around us around Christmas, following us home, walking into our house to stir his affections towards the Lord? I think it's true that God uses unlikely things to bring us to him. And as I said, the resurrection is just an unlikely thing in our world. The resurrection is something that seems just so otherworldly. I mean, if I did a poll of the room, I think I could safely say that none of us know someone that has been resurrected. None of us know someone who has come back from the dead. Yet God would use this unlikely thing, this otherworldly thing, to fulfill and secure all of his promises. Today, if you're taking notes, I want you to write down this bottom line, that the resurrection secures eternal life for those who believe in Jesus. This is what the resurrection is about. This is what Easter is about, that God would use this unlikely thing of a resurrection to bring life to those who are far from him. If you're taking notes, I want you to write down our first point, that we see that there is an unlikely message. Look with me, beginning at Matthew 28, verse 1. Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay, and then go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you." As we enter into this passage, this unlikely message from the Lord, we see what we can describe as some unlikely characters here. We find ourselves walking with the two Marys headed to the tomb, and I think it's very fitting that we encounter these women as our witnesses to the resurrection and the empty tomb. You see, over the years, over the centuries, much has been made about the unlikeliness of the resurrection. Simply put, the number of people that we know that we have in recorded history that have been resurrected are basically one. It's Jesus. He's the one who's been resurrected. And for centuries, people have expressed disbelief that Jesus could have been raised from the dead. This is part of the reason that every one of the Gospels, as they're writing about the resurrection, they write about the empty tomb. They recognize the reality that every writer recognizes. They have seen the tomb. They have seen the risen Savior. They know it is empty, that the resurrection truly occurred. And frankly, I think their confidence in this is shown by the women here being the first witnesses of the resurrection. I want you to consider their culture within ancient Israel. We're talking 2,000 years ago. Their society is male-dominated, that if you are going to call an eyewitness to come bear account for you, that you're not allowed to call a woman to bear witness. They're not legally allowed to participate in the court of law as eyewitnesses. That they are not able to be advocates and to stand before people to proclaim that there is truth to be found here. The entire culture would simply dismiss the work of women and their worthiness to be witnesses in this endeavor. truly, if the disciples were making this up, the last people they would use as witnesses would be women. It's just simply the nature of the culture they live in. Yet, they're very confident in what they've seen, and they find there's no reason to change the story to assure people this might be true. You see, this is the beginning of God, of His people, turning the world upside down, because the first witnesses of the resurrection are not men, but women. They're beginning to show an honor and a value to them in this culture that refuses to do so. And so the world begins to change and turn on these two unlikely women who come before the tomb, this empty tomb, and see that there is no one there. Yet even this arrival to the tomb presents an unlikely work of God. You see, we have an earthquake that is described here that hits that morning, that there's been a few earthquakes just over the last few days with Jesus' death and now with His resurrection this morning. And you might think that that's perhaps just circumstance or just something that is occurring just naturally, yet earthquakes, historically speaking, are really unlikely in Jerusalem. Historically speaking, the average number of earthquakes that they have in Jerusalem every year is equal to the average number of earthquakes we have here in South Carolina. I don't know if you're an expert in tectonic plates and geology, but we don't have a ton of earthquakes here in South Carolina. This is why it's so significant that the Lord is doing unlikely things to display His work. In fact, this earthquake and the earthquakes that occurred here and on Good Friday are so significant that we even have Roman records that they recorded writing about these earthquakes saying, that was weird. These were significant moments that they can mark that when Jesus was crucified and when He was resurrected, even the Roman authorities who denied that Jesus is God would say something significant happened on these days. We have this earthquake occur, and then this angel of the Lord appears and rolls back the stone. This stone that is rolled back, I don't think we put significance on what just occurred here. You see, this stone is about a 4 to 6 foot wide, round, circular stone. This stone can weigh as much as 1 to 2 pounds. We're talking 2 to 4,000 pounds. We know from Jewish burial practices that in order to move the stone into place in the tomb, that it takes a team of over 20 men just to roll it downhill to get it into place. 20 men to simply roll a round stone downhill into place in the tomb. Yet this angel appears, and all that Matthew and the gospel writers tell us about it is that it was rolled away. It sounds as easy and as simple as can be for them. This angel appears, and the angel is described, frankly, just as much as you would expect an angel from God to be like. His clothing is white as snow. He appears like lightning, just rapidly appearing on the scene. Everyone is afraid of Him. His power is on display. This is something that is unlike the rest of us. Yet again, we have unlikely circumstances that are appearing to mark this day. And then this angel begins to speak. And this angel gives the most unlikely message we can find in human history. The angel proclaims to the women, "Do not be afraid." Why? Because Jesus has risen. Do not fear, because Jesus is no longer here in this grave. We know that as we look through the Gospels, we recognize that Jesus told His disciples many times that He would be resurrected from the grave. But consider this statement seriously. I know that we sit on this side of salvation history, and we can say with confidence as we look at the Scriptures, well, of course Jesus was coming back. But place yourself in the shoes of the disciples. Try to put yourself in their position here 2,000 years ago. You see, the disciples have just seen one of their own turn away from them. They've just seen Jesus captured They've had to deny that they know who he is. They've heard or seen that he was beaten. They know that he is crucified because it's the talk of the town in Jerusalem. Furthermore, John, one of the disciples, was there and he saw Jesus take his final breath. They know that Jesus has been buried. They know that the tomb has been sealed and there's a guard set upon it. Putting yourself in their shoes, they know that their rabbi, their teacher, has been murdered. They're probably being looked for. They've given up everything to follow Jesus, and now they have nothing. Everything is crashing in on them. During their terror this weekend, perhaps they also doubted that Jesus would do what he promised to do. It would seem natural that they would have fear and distress that Jesus might not be the Savior he has proclaimed himself to be. This is why the angel proclaims, "Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid." This angel is offering a message of hope for the disciples of Jesus and for us. You see, Jesus, he lives and reigns over his people, his world, today. He has fulfilled all the promises that he made, and even now, he is interceding on our behalf before God the Father. The women and the soldiers that have gathered here at the empty tomb, they see that it is empty. They know that no one is there. And both groups, both parties conclude that there is one answer and one answer only. Jesus has risen. It's the only outcome that they come to. And this unlikely message begins to lead to differing responses for both groups of people here. If you're taking notes with us, I want you to mark our second point that we see an unlikely hope begin here in verse 8. If you're reading with me, look to verse 8. It'll be on the screen. "So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, 'Greetings.' And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me.' While they were going, behold, some of the guard went into the city and told the chief priest all that had taken place. And when they had assembled with the elders and taken counsel, they gave a sufficient sum of money to the soldiers and said, 'Tell people his disciples came by night and stole him away while we were asleep. And if this comes to the governor's ears, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble.' So they took the money and did as they were directed. And this story has been spread among the Jews to this day." In this section, we see the responses of the women and how their responses differ from the responses of the soldiers. As we look to verse 8, we see that the women, they depart with haste to go tell the remaining disciples. It says that there is fear and great joy mingling together with them. This fear is pointing to what I would describe as a reverent awe. They have seen something incredible with the angel coming down to proclaim a message and showing his power. But they've even seen that this angel's power is nothing compared to the power of Jesus, because he has been resurrected from the grave, that he no longer dwells in this tomb. Their great joy is obvious to us as well. Jesus lives. And while Jesus lives, they have hope. Along the way, as they're returning to Jerusalem, they encounter Jesus in the flesh. He greets them and they fall down and worship. And you can feel the passage beginning to turn in terms of going from sorrow to joy. They begin this day with this very small hope of perhaps convincing the guards to open the door, though roll back the stone just enough for them to come in and dress Jesus' body for burial. Yet they end this day with getting to physically hold the risen Savior in their arms. What a turn. What a transformation in their day. Jesus commands them to not be afraid and to go and tell of His resurrection. He's giving them encouragement and hope that He will continue the mission of the Father to see the world redeemed. Jesus came in this world. He lived the perfect life that you and I could not live. He lived the life that we, frankly, need to live. And He went to the cross, an innocent man, dying in our place. He bore the sin and shame that we have created. He bore the wrath of God on our behalf. He gave His life so that in Him we might have life. And then He resurrected from the grave 3 days later, demonstrating His power, His authority over the world. This is what the Father has been working towards through salvation history. The promises He made all the way back in the book of Genesis have been fulfilled through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Jesus has made a way when there was no way for God's people. And now through Jesus, if we trust in Him, we have forgiveness of sin and life eternal. This is the good news the disciples are waiting to hear. They're waiting to hear this good news that Jesus lives, that He has conquered the grave, that everything He proclaimed to His people has come true. And these women get to be the ones who run to the disciples to proclaim the greatest news of all, that Jesus lives. Everything has changed for the disciples. Everything. They've spent this entire weekend lost and confused. But now they have hope and certainty. Why? Well, everything changed when they encountered the risen Savior. Everything changed in their story, in their lives, when they met Jesus. Yet as we celebrate that change in the disciples' lives and in their circumstance, that change that perhaps we've experienced, we recognize that some do not change when they encounter Jesus. You see, we see the soldiers begin to come back into Jerusalem, and we know that they're facing some problems. These are Roman soldiers, and they have failed in their duty to keep the tomb sealed. And they know that if they come back to the governor, they come back to Pontius Pilate, they are in trouble. At worst, they are at minimum, the best case scenario, they're on punishment duty for the next couple of years. At worst, they're going to be executed. And so they know we can't go tell the boss, we got to go find someone who's going to cover for us. They run into Jerusalem and they go to speak to the chief priest. The only ones who can help them are these priests. And the chief priest, they gather with the elders of the people and they begin to determine if they should keep the resurrection a secret. They're not even sure if it's possible to keep it secret, but they are going to try to keep it quiet. They offer a bribe to the soldiers. They give them money, a sufficient sum of money, whatever that is, and they offer them protection. They will keep the soldiers safe if, only if, they will tell people that the disciples stole the body of Jesus. They said, we'll give you money. We'll keep you safe, but you have to tell people that the body of Jesus was stolen while you were sleeping. We recognize these men seemingly follow these orders because Matthew tells us that at the time he's writing this gospel, what we base historical research on, about maybe 30 to 50 years after this event, as Matthew's writing his recollections and his memory of this time, that he tells us it's a very common story that is being circulated just 30 to 50 years after this time. That many people have heard this story and they've believed the lies that have come forth. You see, in this final section, we see two groups of people with two very different responses to the resurrection. The first group is made up of these women and the disciples. They find great joy in the news of the resurrection. They experience hope, rebirth, when they encounter the risen Savior. They trust in Him, and they have seen that He has kept His promises. They recognize the resurrection is good news for them. Yet we have the second group here that's made up of at least some of the soldiers, the chief priests, and the elders of the people. You see, the resurrection for them is not good news. The resurrection for them brings fear and despair. Rather than trust in Jesus, who by all accounts has demonstrated that He is indeed the Messiah and King they've been waiting for, this fits with the prophecies and promises from the Old Testament they would know. Rather than admit He is the Messiah and repent of their sins, they seek to discredit Him. They spread this story that the disciples stole His body. There are a variety of ways that these two groups differ from one another, but I would submit to you that the key way they differ is their view of what the resurrection brings. You see, the disciples, they believe that the resurrection brings to them a life with no end. They believe the resurrection is good news because it brings eternal life to them. They recognize that they've got forgiveness of sin. They'll spend eternity with Jesus. This is good news. The soldiers and the priests and the elders of the people, they believe that the resurrection brings an end to their life. They believe the resurrection is bad news for their circumstances. They believe that there is no hope for them at this point. I would ask you, what group do you find yourself in today? Do you look upon the resurrection as good news of bringing hope and restoration to you? Or is it bad news because you are required to change? Is it bad news because it requires you to give some things up in order to worship the risen Savior? Or is it good news because you recognize those things were perishing anyway and you will have eternal life with Jesus? You see, the gospel is very clear as we study the scriptures, looking through the Old and New Testament together. We recognize this truth, that every one of us has sinned. We've all fallen short of the glory of God, that we are all guilty of sin that we have committed. And because of that sin, it has created a gap, a separation between us and God. And with that gap, we have no way to have a relationship with God. We have no way to get to Him. That is bad enough, but because of our sin, because of our shame, God desires nothing to do with us. He is holy and perfect, and we are unrighteous and in rebellion against Him. You could say that God would be justified to do nothing in that circumstance, and you would be right. Yet God, in His rich love and mercy, made a way where there was no way. You see, the only way that gap could be bridged is if someone paid the debt of sin and shame. Yet, who can pay that debt of sin and shame when everyone is guilty of sin? God Himself must come into the story and pay the debt for His people. And we see that God comes into the story in the form of a baby child named Jesus. God comes into this story as a small child and lives life just as you and I would, growing, gaining knowledge. Yet there is a key difference. Jesus was perfect. He never sinned. He never fell short of the standard that God set for Him. And because of this, Jesus began His ministry as a perfect man, sinless, being fully man and fully God, lived the life that we could not. And as he went to that cross, being beaten and scourged and condemned for proclaiming that the gospel brings good news to his people, he died the death that we deserved. He bore the wrath of God. And on that cross, God and man died together. But the story doesn't end there, because Jesus was resurrected from the grave 3 days later. And he walked this earth and was seen by many people. And he dwells now in heaven, interceding on our behalf before God. This is the good news of the resurrection. That no matter where you are, no matter what you've done, there is hope for you and for I. And so today, this Resurrection Sunday, there are many things we could say, there are many things we can do, but today we're simply going to recognize that for every one of us, no matter where we are in our spiritual journey, that our response today is that we should look to God the Father for forgiveness that can only come through Jesus Christ. That we should confess our sin and our brokenness, and we should cry out to the Lord Jesus for forgiveness and for mercy. So here in the next few moments, you'll have opportunity to confess your sin to the Lord. Perhaps it'll be for the first time. Maybe it's for the 1,000th time. But together, we'll be able to offer our sin to the Lord, seeking forgiveness. What I'll do is I'll give you a few moments of silent prayer, and then I'll pray for us to wrap up our time. And we'll together have one final song of worshiping the Lord and celebrating his grace and mercy. And then, if that's not a good enough into our day, we'll step outside and celebrate baptism, celebrating someone crossing from death to life on this Easter Sunday. So I hope and I pray that you'll allow the Lord to work and move in your lives today. If I may, could I go to the Lord in prayer together for us? Would you pray with me? Father, we come to you today in awe of your amazing work of love for your people. Lord, it is mind-boggling to know that you looked upon a rebellious people who were in sin, and your answer, your desire was to bring restoration to them. Lord, you would have been justified to do nothing. You would have been fine to do nothing, yet in your love, in your grace and mercy, you said, "These people are mine. I will make a way that they could have eternal life with me." Lord, this is a beautiful, beautiful thing to hear, because this is good news for us. This means that we get to have access to you. This means that we get to spend eternity with you, Lord. And so, Father, it is our prayer that today that we could look upon you. We could look upon the risen Savior of Jesus Christ. That we could rejoice and celebrate in the forgiveness of sin that we've been given. And that we could celebrate the eternal life that we will have with you. Lord, what a beautiful thing to long for. Recognizing that we have been forgiven, our sin and shame is no more, and that we'll spend eternity rejoicing with you. Lord, this is indeed good news. And today, Lord, I pray that every man, woman, and child here would hear this good news. They would see it lived out. And they would respond to a resurrected Savior. Lord, today everyone will make a decision, just as the disciples or the soldiers did. Lord, it is my prayer that everyone would see the gospel as good news, they would recognize that today is the day the Lord has made for them to know He is good. Lord, we're thankful for You. We pray that You bless us with Your presence. We pray these things in Your name. Amen. Would you stand and worship with us?
The head that once was crowned with thorns, it's crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now let His feet we bow. Who wore our sin and shame, now robed in majesty. The radiance of perfect love now shines for all to see.
All praise will rise to Christ our King. sing me.
Amen, amen. Well, stay standing because we're going to be quick. I want to invite you to gather with us on the front lawn because we are going to have the baptism of Gino in a few minutes. Yes. But I got to give you some clear directions. We got to be clear about what we're doing. Baptism is an outward expression of the inward faith. This is the Lord working in our hearts, bringing us to celebrate and worship what He's done. It is basically putting on a jersey and saying that I am on Team Jesus. And so, when we do this, this is a big, incredible, exciting moment. And it deserves big, loud, exciting celebration. So, here's what I don't want. Can you guys give me a quiet Masters golf clap? Just kind of a, yeah. That's right, yeah, Jared, I know. That's the right enthusiasm for a moment like that. That's not what baptism is. Baptism is your biggest, your loudest, your most intense moment. So, can you guys show me what this should look like? There you go. That was better, but I don't think that's good enough. I need more. So turn it up to 11 and show me. On three. 1, 2, 3. There we go. That's what I want to hear outside. So let me pray for us, and we'll go onto the lawn to celebrate baptism. If you would you pray with me? Father, thank you for today. Thank you for letting us rejoice and celebrate in your goodness. Lord, today as we celebrate the resurrection, let us never forget the work that was done for us through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Lord, thank you for the good news of the gospel that we can have life and hope. Lord, I pray that you send us out to be a blessing this week, proclaiming the good news of the gospel to a lost and dying world. Thank you, Father, for what you've done for your people. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. We love you guys. Happy Easter.